Good evening, everyone, and thank you for being here with us today. My name is Keith Marzullo, and I'm the Dean of the University of Maryland's College of Information Studies, what we call the iSchool. We're all excited that you're here for this informative panel discussion, Discover Your Path iSchool Career Panel. Now I'm pleased to introduce you to the co-moderators of the discussion who are also members of the iSchool Alumni Network Board. Please join me in welcoming Susie Wilson and Katy Olieva. Welcome here. I'll hand it over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Marzullo, for that lovely introduction. We're trying to get through a lot of questions in a short amount of time, so if you all don't mind, I'll go ahead and jump right into the questions with our panelists. I just want to point out that I will address certain questions to specific folks, but if you have something to add and I didn't call your name, feel free to jump in at any time. To kick us off, if you could briefly tell us about your career path and what interested you to pursue this field, and if you could say a little bit of your name and what you do at the university also, that'd be wonderful.
Good evening, everybody. Josh Rattan. I'm a partner with PricewaterhouseCoopers, or otherwise known as PwC. I am a Maryland grad. I also am part of the iLead Council for the iSchool and work very closely with Dean Marzullo and other faculty in that capacity. I, as a practitioner in the space of information management and information science, you know, a lot of the issues that I help clients to manage and solve are interdisciplinary, bring a number of different information management and domain disciplines together. And so it's been great to work with the iSchool and give back to UMD and getting to know Keith and the faculty in and around those concepts, and certainly looking forward to the discussion today and any way I can help the attendees think about their career path and their path forward. So nice to meet everybody and look forward to a good discussion.
Hi everyone, my name is Katy Lawley and I am a faculty member in the iSchool. Briefly, my career path, I joined the iSchool as a student in the Master's of Library. Back then it was a Master's of Library Science program in 1999. And I planned on just getting an MLS and moving along to a career in librarianship. But I got really excited about the broader discipline of information studies. So I stayed and got my PhD. And then I stayed on as a faculty member. Before I went to UMD, I also worked in an academic library at the University of Georgia. And I've done a little bit of freelance consulting. And I think more responsible for my presence here today is the fact that I'm the iSchool's career services liaison. So I work with students and alumni on, you know, career prep, career transitions, getting to know the field. So I'm excited to speak with y'all today.
So I'm Bill Coolis. I'm the director of the Human Computer Interaction Master's program here, and I'm also the director of the iConsultancy, which is the group that that brings a lot of the capstone projects to our undergraduate and to our master's courses. So if you've done a capstone project, there's a good chance I've been involved in some element of it. I worked in the software industry for about 20 years. I started out as a programmer, as a database developer, and then I moved my way up to sort of a system engineer. And along the way, I found myself getting more and more interested in the human side and the organizational side of the systems I was building. So I started, eventually I got my doctorate in computer science, but with a focus on human-computer interaction. And that's what I've sort of been focusing on over the past 10 or 15 years in my academic role. I'll leave it at that for now.
Okay. Hi everyone, I'm Ursula Gorham. I have been a part of the UMD community for about 20 years now, on and off, when I first started as a grad school in public policy, as a grad student in public policy. So here at the iSchool, I have been a lecturer since 2015, and I'm currently the director of the MLIS program. So I was actually an attorney before I came to library and information science, and for me at least, like the fields are really closely related. So essentially, I transitioned from intensely using a certain body of information as a lawyer to helping others find and use information when I was a librarian, and then to helping my students become skilled information professionals who can help others in my current role. So when I was a lawyer, even though I wouldn't have called it this, what I was really interested in was information literacy. And honestly, nothing has really changed for me. This idea of how to connect people with information that they can use to improve their lives is really central to our field. And I love that I've been able to study this and research this and teach about it.
Thank you to all the panelists for all those lovely introductions and what really inspired everyone. So for the next question, I'm gonna go ahead and ask in this order, Bill, Ursula, and Josh to answer. But after each one speaks, anyone else can chime in to add on. And I would like to ask, how has your field changed in the past 5 years? And how much demand is there for people in this career?
Sure, Kat. Thanks for the question. So, I'm going to talk about two aspects of it. One is the UX field specifically. That's got a lot of opportunities, and it's a very strong field. It's also competitive, though, and I think that as more jobs are coming online, there's also, you know, more demand, but there's also just a lot more expectations about students being able to show not just that they have the technical skills, but also the soft skills. I think that plays out generally is true in the broader information science field also. And as I've been talking to alumni, students who I've taught a few years ago who have been out a couple of years, they're telling me that similar things is that there's good markets and certain things are particularly hot, like cyber and other areas like that are growing. But there's also, they're applying to a lot of jobs to find the right to get those interviews. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. I would say that the demand for librarians and other related information professionals is really strong. Our libraries, our archives, our museums, they're not going anywhere. And graduates of our program find themselves working in not only those institutions, so not only public and academic libraries and places like NARA and Library of Congress and the Smithsonian, but we're also seeing our graduates go into positions in a whole range of public, private, and nonprofit organizations. So, we have seen an increasing number of our graduates working in intelligence agencies, in law and accounting firms sometimes, and even companies in the private sector like Disney and Harrah's. And so I think what we've seen in terms of trends with the field is that in the past 5 years, we're just seeing more of these trends developing in terms of the fact that the skills and the knowledge that we give our students the opportunity to gain while they're in our program. And so this is everything from information organization to needs assessment to user instruction. All of those skills really are widely applicable in both traditional and perhaps like non-traditional settings. And the other thing I would note is increasingly that we are seeing our graduates, again, like in all of these different types of institutions, really working and serving as navigators, where they're using the skills and the knowledge that they have to really connect users and communities to the information that they need.
I'm up next. I'll build on, Ursula and Bill's comments. So, what I would say first and foremost to give some context to my answers is that as a practitioner helping clients to understand their information estates and then put controls or enhance how information can be located, how experts can be identified, et cetera, the number one skill set from, you know, my work and perspective is to help clients know how to take the proper steps to build those information architectures and to apply techniques that I would imagine many of the attendees here today think about and are learning about and are growing around. What I think is underappreciated is that the skills that the team here are getting experience on are really germane to a lot of the very technical transformation and cybersecurity capabilities and requirements that clients are coming up with and are demanding. And so in my world, in the last 5 years, terms like digital transformation, cloud transformation, cyber readiness, even those issues around privacy, like the recent California law passed CPRA, they all demand an understanding of what information you have, where is it, how sensitive is it, its aboutness, and then to do something with that knowledge. And so with that, we've been, as a firm, looking for and sourcing talent that can help our clients navigate those use cases. And iSchools, particular UMD, has been really instrumental in providing the skills that are needed to be at the forefront. So just because you're not, let's say, or a student isn't in a cybersecurity, curriculum, or isn't in a computer science curriculum, or, you know, fill in the blank relative to the latest and greatest buzzwords, how important the skills that you're building are to those cutting edge, really interesting and growing fields. It's really incredible. So you should feel like you're in a really good spot.
Thank you so much for your insight, everyone. Next question, what specific qualifications and skills should someone develop before entering the job market? And this one is marked as for anyone, but if we could, I'd like to start with Katie, if possible.
Sure. So, you're probably going to hear a recurring theme today, and that theme has to do with the combination of like technical and applied skills and soft skills. The soft skills are really important to bring. And those are the skills that have to do with having the ability to communicate with different parties, to manage complexity and prioritize tasks, right? To be able to organize yourself and your tasks and other people on a job. So you always want to be working on those and those team projects, for current and prospective students. Your team projects are a great opportunity to get experience with both your soft skills and your technical skills. And when I say technical, I'm not just limiting that to technological. For some of the careers that you're interested in going into, it does do you well to beef up on the technology. But if you don't want to be in a role where you're heavily using, programming languages or software platforms, especially in the MLIS program, there's a lot of room for you to specialize in technical processes like archives, preservation, and certain aspects of library science. So in terms of the technological skills, it always helps, if you're interested in becoming technologically proficient, it always helps to beef up on a programming language that makes sense for your area. So if you want to crunch numbers and be a data person, then you want to get familiar with languages like R and Python. But if you want to be more on the design side, then you want to work with HTML and CSS and also learn some of the software platforms that let you implement designs like Figma and the Adobe Creative Suite. So you know, there's really not one answer, especially for the breadth of interest that, you know, people have when they come to the iSchool. But it's just about looking for opportunities, either while you're in school or if you're no longer in school, to take on personal projects. So if you're in school, you want to be strategic about the team projects that you do for your courses or the individual projects that you do for your courses, because you can put those projects on your resume as experience. They're different than work experience, but recruiters and hiring managers are accustomed to seeing academic projects listed on a resume. And that's where you can specify, you know, what your strategies were. If it was a team project, they want to know what was your role on the team. And you can also get great fodder for interview questions from your project experiences. So I'll leave it there and see what kinds of questions come up and see if any of my co-panelists have anything to add.
Would any other co-panelists like to add anything?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Ursula, please.
Okay. So I would add that because this is something that we see with our MLIS students a lot, that they may come in feeling a little overwhelmed in terms of what they should be focused on in terms of their technical skills. And the problem, and maybe the opportunity, is that technology changes so fast, right? And so for our program, I think we've kind of focused on really encouraging our students to just get comfortable with technology, right? Because if you focus too much on one, by the time you're out on the job market, then it may not be as relevant anymore. And so kind of speaking to what Katie was saying about like the soft skills, I think another one is like adaptability, right? And just being able to roll with the punches. And part of that in the job, you know, in a job setting is being able to pick up new skills and being able to on the spot learn something that maybe you came into the job not knowing that you were going to need to learn. And so to the extent that so many of our courses now incorporate either technical skills or technological skills, I think that's what really preps students to just kind of adjust to the reality of the workplace.
Yep, I would just echo what was said, and just add two things. One, couldn't agree more. The top performers that are in my world are also having to be the best communicators. Second, I would say is that you should appreciate that your learning journey continues post-graduation, and that you should make sure that you appreciate that you're really learning how to learn more than you're learning a specific skill or trade that suddenly will persist for your entire career. Said differently, like in, you know, I guess 19, 20 years ago now, which sounds like I'm ancient, you know, graduated having learned C++ and Java in undergrad. I hardly use those skills today. It's all about, you know, reactive design, React.js, Python, scripting languages, Swift, all of those different things. And it was more about me learning, you know, what makes a language and how to use it so I can apply that as I go along. And you could come up with multiple examples, but just being a lifelong learner, it sounds kitschy, but it is incredibly, incredibly important.
I'll just add on to that, you know, just echo what Katie and everybody else was saying, having those soft skills is essential. And then I think if you are, you know, you need to have a broad set of the technical skills, and I use the word technical very broadly, you know, information organization, ranging, you know, programming, you know, all those skills. You need to have a good broad understanding of all those skills across the discipline. And then you need to be able to point where you go deep. So you sometimes hear this T-shaped metaphor used. And particularly at the master's level, your employers are going to be interested in knowing what are your specific skills. a little bit less so at the undergrad level, where people expect you to have a good broad setting, but maybe not quite so in depth. But regardless, you should be able to, you should have a good broad set of skills and have at least some area where you're focusing and can talk in more depth about a particular skill area.
Thank you, everyone. And going off of both talking about technical and soft skills, would you say that either one or the other is more important to succeed in this field? And how exactly can someone set themselves apart from the rest of the applicants? And we can follow the same order, starting with Katie.
So which is more important, the technical skills or the soft skills? I would say probably the soft skills, because I think they're more broadly applicable if I had to choose a favorite. But the technical skills, again, depending on where you want to go and what you want to do, if working closely with technology as a tool is going to be important, then having the ability to, you know, having comfort with technology. And just like Ursula was saying, it doesn't matter as much what the specific technology is that you use, as long as you develop, you know, in Josh's words, that lifelong learning model of just being like, oh, hey, there's a new software product to do so-and-so. I think I'll give it a try and just do, you know, like do a personal project, you know, organize your DVDs or your spice cabinet using a new database tool, you know, just to try it out. And you probably be able to transfer skills that you learn from another database tool that you use, just as an example. And then building soft skills, it's harder because you can always take, you know, a Code Academy class to learn a programming language. But soft skills are something that everybody wants you to have and nobody tells you how to get. So my advice would be, again, I'm gonna go back to, you know, putting yourself out there however you can, getting engaged with projects and class and your workplace and your home with your spice cabinet, or in your, you know, religious or civic organizations that you're involved with. If you can somehow volunteer or take on a project in any aspect of your life, then you're practicing. Practice communicating with people, practice organizing things, and build yourself up some examples that you can sort of promote about yourself as a skill that you have.
Would any of the panelists like to add anything?
Be okay with trying and not doing a good job, and then keep doing it again and again and again. And I guess I would just say, look, you know, technical skills will open up the door. The soft skills will close the deal. Certainly a lot of the folks that I interview, et cetera, you know, they have great resumes. The ones that are able to communicate with impact and with empathy why their skills are relevant and how they've applied them makes all the difference. That becomes a really critical aspect to things. And I would say that not only those that sort of get those, you know, initial jobs or, you know, next jobs, the ones that tend to succeed are the ones that are willing to communicate with impact, kind of make themselves heard, put out compelling ideas, et cetera. And so just putting yourself out there, you know, as was shared, is really important.
I'd like to butt back in, if I may, because, you know, Josh made me realize something that's also important is, don't only be thinking about yourself in this, okay? So when you're trying to get that promotion or the new job or the new project at your work, you need to be able to, you know, to think about the pain points and the needs of whomever it is you're trying to entice to hire you or use your skills in a new way. And you need to be able to sell your skills and experiences in a way that's going to fall on their ears as, wow, this is somebody who can really help us out. Because you can be really impressive in lots of ways, but if the skills that you're bringing to the table aren't the skills that they need right now, then they might be impressed with you, but they might not want to hire you. So just make sure you're familiar with those job descriptions, you're familiar with your organizational missions for the places where you want to be.
I would add that for kind of our part of the field, library and information science, we have a lot of students that come to our program as a second or third career. And so you come with like really rich, interesting experience. And I think sometimes students can kind of back away from thinking about how what they did in previous jobs can help them in their jobs going forward. And there's honestly nothing further than the truth. Like, I have had students, particularly in, like our introductory courses, kind of downplaying the fact that they have really great customer service experience from working retail, right? And acting like that doesn't matter. But for anyone that has worked in a public library or in any sort of public facing role, those customer service skills really, really matter and they transfer. And then the other thing I would say is, if you are looking at working in a smaller organization, chances are you end up wearing a lot of different hats, right? And so again, that's where these skills that you've developed in your, you know, previous life can really come into play. And I would just say don't downplay them. I mean, they can really make you stand out as an applicant.
Just touching on this organizational size, that does affect the degree of specialization. The job that you're going into is going to impact a little bit the balance of hard versus soft or technical versus non-technical skills that you're going to need. If you are, you know, if you end up going into a very, you know, to a computer programming position where you're just coding or just creating web pages, then those technical skills are going to be really important. And maybe the balance leans towards that. But really, you always need the soft skills. You always need the problem solving skills, ways of looking at and reframing problems. You always need the ability to be able to operate comfortably with uncertainty and ambiguity. And I want to put a plug in for any of you that are about to take a capstone course, because that's what we do with the capstones, is we bring projects and you're able to actually work on projects with support, but where you're actually practicing how to apply the technical skills you've been learning in an environment where you are also practicing the professional skills. And I've talked to a number of alumni over the past couple of weeks, and they're like, oh God, those projects that we worked on, but they were the things that I was able to talk about. Oh my God, all those presentations I have to give, but that was the thing that made me comfortable giving the presentations. So so even though and we put a lot of work into trying to create opportunities for you to really hone those professional skills. So take that, you know, take advantage of those opportunities.
Thank you all. Our next question is building right off of this conversation about soft skills and communication. And this is specifically for Katie and Josh. How can I express that I'm willing to learn skills that I do not currently have during an interview? And then second part, or how can I communicate soft skills that we've been talking about during an interview or on my resume?
So for the first question, you know, how can I communicate willingness to learn? Say it, you know, just go ahead and be forthcoming about, you know, because, you know, when you're in an interview, you're with somebody who's already familiar with what's on your resume and what's not on your resume when they're thinking about their needs for the position. So you can express, number one, your willingness to learn, and you can also express your capability to learn. And that takes me to the second question. So, you know, the stories that you tell, number one, are going to be your evidence that you have what they're looking for in the position. You can say, I'm a self-starter. You can say, I'm a good communicator. But it's a lot more effective if you show it by telling a story about a project that you've worked on, a situation of conflict that you've resolved, lessons that you've learned, you know, through the University of Hard Knocks, right? So yeah, I think just being selective about your stories, those stories also, when they're personal and when they have, you know, some sort of hook, they help your interviewers remember you when they're talking about, you know, they get together at the end of the week and they talk about the 5 or 6 or 10 people that they interviewed this week. And the ones who told the interesting stories are the ones who are going to come up in their minds during those conversations. So put yourself out there, get experiences, do projects, and then go into interviews and tell stories about them.
I'll build on that, echoing everything that Katie shared. So two things that I like to ask in an interview, and I would encourage you to share these types of stories unprompted. One is, what do you do outside of your schoolwork and your current job that would illustrate that you're willing to put in the extra time and effort to learn a skill when nobody's watching, nobody's asking, and it's just you and you want to do it? And it could be on any topic. And similarly, I would venture to guess that if somebody were to ask you, what are you passionate about, that you're going to tell about something that, you know, you are willing to do it in nights and weekends and whatever. So for me, I am a passionate golfer and I love to play, and it is my outdoor, you know, activity when I am able to sort of escape the kids and all of that stuff. And I'm always at the range, and it kind of factors into that 10,000 hours rule. Like, how do I get better? I play in tournaments. I measure my progress. I watch videos on YouTube. I work out to get more flexible and build my skills. Like, you may not think that that's germane to a job interview. It certainly may seem a little foreign to, trying to land a cloud engineering role or something like that. But what it does demonstrate, in my opinion, is that you're willing to take the extra time when nobody's giving you the training class, asking you to get to learn a new skill, making you do something, and you could make it about anything. And to me, that really reinforces how you're willing to go above and beyond. And I'll just sort of round this out, which is to say, at least in my world, you learn one of three ways. You're going to learn it by yourself because you want to do it. You're going to learn it because you have to, because you got, you know, put on a new project or engagement and it's just there. And the third and least likely is that, the lower percentage is that you get a training course and that the firm or the organization carves out 2 weeks so you can go and deep dive on something. Like, that might happen very seldomly. So the way you're going to show this is that you're willing to do it above and beyond when nobody's looking.
Thank you. So we have about 8 minutes left of the general panelists' questions before we open up to general Q&As. So if you have any questions, you can send it in the Q&A box. And as our last question, we want to ask what the best advice you can give to those pursuing a career in the field. And Bill, Ursula, Josh, Katie, if you all want to do some advice.
Cool. Well, I'll start if you're pursuing the careers, there's a couple of pieces of advice that particularly is, one is, as you are starting to look, I think the MLS field is a little different, but in terms of the information management, HCIM, and in information science in general, look broadly at don't just limit yourself to looking for specific job titles, because the job titles vary a lot. They overlap. They have used different titles for the same thing. I've talked to a number of students who sort of discovered this, that, oh, I really needed to look broadly, just because the job titles don't tell you everything. Really look at the descriptions and really understand, as you are looking for jobs, and then as you're stepping into your interviews and starting to learn about the companies, really dig in and try to understand what the job involves there also. I'll stop there because I want to give everybody else a chance.
I'll go. I think two pieces of advice. One, I'd say, like, the common theme, like the thread among all of our students is that they are curious about things. Lean into that, like, stay curious when you're in school. And you may have a really great idea of what you want to do when you graduate, but life happens sometimes. And, you know, the environment changes and, you know, the world changes a little bit. And, you know, we've been in a pandemic now for a year. And so I think that's a great example of it. And so be curious and be open to, you know, the different paths that are out there. And then the other advice I have, and you've heard it a million times, but network and talk to people. We have some really great professional associations in our field, you know, for libraries and archives and other cultural heritage organizations. And they love when students get involved. They love when students offer to volunteer and actually, like, get actively involved. And the connections that you make starting, you know, whether you do it as a student or as an early professional, the more you talk to people, the more you find out about the opportunities that are out there. I'll say almost every alumni that I've talked to that has had, like, a really, you know, interesting career, so much of it has come down to just putting themselves out there and really talking to different people and not always, like, angling to get a job, but just finding out. Again, it's that curiosity, finding out what other people are doing and what's interesting to them. So that's my advice.
Katie, you want to go?
Okay. I'm going to be a hog and I'm going to give you three pieces of advice, but I'll be brief. Number one, apply anyway, okay? Even if you don't tick all the boxes, and especially if it's a position that you're passionate about, apply anyway. Number two is be yourself, and make an effort to bring yourself forward into, you know, whatever communication tools it is that you have. Whether it's a cover letter, or maybe you're applying for a position that doesn't require a cover letter. That means you need to put an objective statement on your resume. You need to find some way to get your personality in there, because, again, like with the stories, those are the things that are going to make you stand out as an individual and not just some data points on a piece of paper. And I forgot what my third piece was, so I'll just let Josh take it.
Thanks, Katie. I guess the only one thing I would echo is Ursula's comment around networking. I was going to call it relationships. The one thing that I have found very quickly is that the opportunities that you get, you'll get a starting point, but the opportunities that you get as you mature in your career and go along are likely going to be generated through the relationships that you create and maintain throughout your career. And the more you can combine that, that great relationship and cultivate, like, a relationship networking skill with being, you know, I guess in a professional sense, a personal brand, being known for skills and capabilities, I think the world's your oyster in terms of job opportunities and experiences. And what ends up happening is you don't necessarily, over time, have to sell yourself. You get pulled into because somebody you know has an interesting need that requires the combination of your skills, and they know you, and you just get pulled in. And people are like, how did you do that? And it's because you've sort of laid that groundwork. So never turn down an opportunity to connect and get to know people. You never know where that will lead you, and it becomes really incredible. Find ways to, you know, make a lot of deposits and give your time to create those connections. And they may not pay off in the near term, but they certainly will over time. So give it a shot.
Thank you all so much. We're gonna go ahead and move into the Q&A portion. If you have a question, please use the raise your hand feature if you would like to ask it live, or you can submit it through the Q&A feature and we'll read it out for you. We have a few submitted so far, so I'm gonna kick us off here. Our first question is, do you recommend that new MLIS students start with a really clear idea of what they want to do and stick with it? Or would you recommend going in with an open mind to explore different career options? So probably for Ursula or Katie.
So honestly, it's hard to say like what I would recommend, but I would echo what I just said, which is be open. I think it's possible to do both, actually, to have a clear idea of what you want to do, but also just take the time to do a little bit of exploration, because, you know, to me, graduate school is that time to do that, right? And you may not get that time or as much time to do that once you actually graduate. So even if, you know, I'll give an example, you come in saying, I want to be an academic librarian, you may not even fully know what that means. And so like, as you begin to take your classes, you're going to learn different aspects of academic librarianship that may end up pointing you in different directions, and, you know, go with it. And, you know, I think the most important thing is by the end of the program to feel as though you have developed this set of skills and this kind of mass of knowledge that you're excited about, and that, you know, you really think about the different ways that you can use it.
Okay, our next question we have here. There are so many project management certifications, software specific certifications, cybersecurity, etc. It seems like many jobs want candidates who have these certifications already rather than offering opportunities to earn them on the job. How important is it to get these before trying to apply?
I'll take that one. I mean, and in my experience, you know, I guess certifications are certainly helpful. I don't think it's really a matter of having a ton of certifications as much as it is being able to demonstrate passion and experience where appropriate. I wouldn't look at a job posting or an opportunity and say, man, I got to tick all the boxes. I think it was said before, don't self-select yourself out of the position. Let the recruiters and your, you know, let them do that work for you. And you're never going to know unless you submit. I mean, if you're looking for practical sort of training and certifications, you really can't go wrong with those that have broad applicability, but I wouldn't call them gating requirements. So, you know, nobody's going to turn down somebody with a PMP certification, project management certification. There's definitely going to be needs around, you know, certain certifications in the space like CISSP or cloud certifications, but don't make it a gating issue or a requirement in your own mind. And you can pick those up as you go along. So that's my perspective, at least.
Thank you. So our next question up is, what is the job market like for UX designers and product designers in a post-pandemic world?
I can tackle that one. So the I think the short answer is it's going to be good. And there's differences. It's going to be good overall. but the folks that I'm talking to, the alumni that I'm talking to, are, you know, there's a lot of jobs that they're getting that they're seeing advertised, in both larger and smaller companies. And I think part of if you're interested in that kind of field is to think about what you know, where do you want to focus your efforts on? Are you interested in, going down different paths. So I'm going to stick with the question, which is the market, the job market looks good from everybody that I'm talking to.
I just want to reinforce that and say, you know, every week I prepare a newsletter of internship and career opportunities. And I, you know, always try to include UX positions in those for the HCIM students and the undergrad students who are interested in those positions. And there's never no hits. Every company or organization that has an app or a website needs UX designers, and many of them also hire product designers. So it's a pretty robust market right now.
I will add that the way the jobs are structured is probably going to change a lot. The industry, you hear that, industry is coming back hybrid, online, remote. That was something that was happening a lot in the tech industry and in the UX field a lot. And I think it's just accelerating, and there will be going back to offices, but there'll also be a lot more remote and distributed teams. So the structure of the jobs is going to change a bit.
Thank you. Our next question, could someone talk about what types of information careers might be available in the world of the arts?
I am not in the arts, so I don't think I can opine on that.
I paused for a moment because I thought Ursula might want to take that one.
Yeah, no, I can. So this is, I would say, a small, consistent sector within libraries, archives, and museums. There are not tons of jobs in this area. It's specifically if you're thinking about working for a performing arts library or something like that. But I'd also say that there are opportunities in thinking non-traditionally, like some of the nonprofit organizations. So for example, we've had students that have gone to work for theater companies, and I had a student that did an internship working with, I believe it was a church, and dealing with their music and cataloging their music, and actually got into a lot of interesting issues about copyright, because they were streaming performances online and everything like that. So I think that if the arts is kind of where you see your home, then it's worth looking into organizations and looking at the support that they need to make their organization run. Because honestly, the skills related to information organization and management are really going to help any sort of organization work. And so this again is kind of taking your skills and thinking about how you can describe them to someone who may look at your degree and be like, library science, what does that have to do with what we do? But if you explain it in terms of the information organization and use, then you can begin to see the connections.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Our next question, which I believe is going off of some advice that Katie gave us earlier in our session, how do you find volunteering opportunities for the purposes of learning?
Oh, that's a good question. You're kind of calling me out on that one, aren't you? This goes in with the advice that you've been getting from a lot of us about networking. Start local. So if you're involved or engaged with any civic or religious organizations. You know, if you belong to a church or a temple or a mosque, or if you play league sports in your community, you know, there's always the opportunity to take on a project, organizing something for those kinds of organizations. If there's nothing in your immediate, you know, field of vision that looks like it would be a good match, it also depends on what kind of project you're looking to do. You know, do you want to build a website for somebody? Do you want to, you know, do you want to do some data analysis? So, you know, so that being said, it depends on what you want to do. If you don't see anything in your immediate field where you think, wow, you know, that pickup basketball, you know, group that I play with on Friday afternoons, we could actually like develop an app to start looking at different like blacktops and scheduling games, you know. So maybe that's a project you could take on. But if you don't see anything like that, you can also just start asking your network, asking your friends. If you're on LinkedIn, you could post something on LinkedIn that says, hey, I'm looking for a data analysis. I'm looking for an app development. I'm looking for a UX project to get involved with, just on a personal project basis. Does anybody have anything for me? And somebody will want your help for sure. So hopefully that'll be fruitful for you.
Thank you so much. Next question, what kinds of roles, experiences, skills, or education are needed to go into an administration leadership position? And in a similar vein, how does administration fit or relate to information sectors? It's a good question.
What do we mean by administration position? What are you...
I read it to mean leadership, probably, like administration leadership.
Okay. Well, I'll just take it as a leadership position. So hopefully we're doing it justice. The folks that I find to be compelling leaders and the ones that I find to become leaders tend to have great soft skills and an intellectual curiosity and an ability to ask questions. I guess it's the willingness to listen and not educate understand a problem but not be dogmatic or like just tell everybody how it's got to be their way. But look, I think the things that we're highlighting that I keep coming back to, in my opinion, are communication and your ability to cultivate those other soft skills, relationship building, empathy, those types of things. I guess said differently, what keeps people, in my opinion, from becoming leaders are those skills. And you will come across time and time again in my field, at least, with just impressive backgrounds with tons of domain and technical experience, and sort of that the challenge for them is to be able to communicate with impact, with clarity, etc. And that is something that they then have to work on and really cultivate.
I'll add one point to that, which is if you're interested in leadership, there are always, from the first time you step into your job, there's always opportunities to be leading. And the soft skills that Josh was talking about are all, and that we've been talking about all evening, are key things that you can be bringing to your team, bringing to your organization. You can be a leader without necessarily being the manager. And that means, you know, being able to contribute good ideas, to creatively problem solve, you know, and that is a path to formal leadership, is by just being able to be a good contributor, both technically and in terms of facilitating the team and helping bring good ideas to the table.
I just say that's spot on in my opinion, Bill. I know we got a ton of more questions, but I would just echo that because I think it's such an important point. it's very seldom that somebody's going to be like, hey, you can be a leader, and then you get the job and then you get to become a leader. It is actually that you've demonstrated it all along and then somebody recognizes those qualities in you. So don't wait to be asked. Totally agree, Bill. Totally agree.
All right. I believe we have time for, I don't know. Do we have time for one more question?
Sure.
Okay. So we're going to group two together. So how do the courses in the HCIM program help your portfolio to suit the job roles that you apply for? And what are some of the key qualities that recruiters would look for in a portfolio? And then along the same vein, are there any campus resources for helping with structuring a UX designer portfolio resume similar to how there are for standard resumes? And I believe that's probably for Bill.
Yeah, I suspect Katie might have a little something to add too. So in terms of our HCIM program, almost every course that we have is designed to help you not only build the skills, but also build to produce things that you can put in your portfolio, designs, research studies, whatever it is. So each of the courses is actually designed to help you start building things for your portfolio. With that said, your portfolio is not just the sum of everything you create in a class. And we actually have a course for our HCIM students that's all about how you create your UX portfolio, your HCI portfolio, and how you curate things. And sometimes you'll have a different portfolio for different kinds of jobs. So those are a few things to keep in mind. I don't know, Katie, if you have anything you want to add in terms of maybe what are recruiters looking for when they're looking at a portfolio?
Recruiters are, I actually went to a recruiting session at a video game company recently. Or it was a session where recruiters were talking with people interested in working there. And I go and eavesdrop on these sessions whenever I can. So what I heard at that session and also in other conversations is, of course, they wanna see, you know, they want to see good design and good organization in your portfolio, but they also want to know what your role is and what your passion is. So, you know, when you're putting on your resume, this is for design positions or others. It was given in the context of design, but I think it's good advice generally. If you want to put a team project, whether it's a professional project or an academic project on your resume, you should describe your role on the team. So that if, you know, your teammates had applied for the same position and put the same project on there, the recruiter would be able to tell, you apart from each other. And I thought that was good advice.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you all. I believe we are at time for our panelists today. If you submitted a question and answer that we didn't get a chance to read, I apologize. But what will happen is we will distribute them to the panelists and then we will send the questions in writing after the event.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for taking the time. Yeah.
Thank you for being here today. We appreciate
Thanks for joining us. And thank you to Kati and Susie for moderating and to Claudia and Shar and the rest of the team for organizing this event. Great job.
Yes. Great job, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.
Have a good night.
Everyone.
Bye. Bye.